Hello, this is the audiobook entitled, Is That the Reason I Get Abused? Author is Jef Gazley, MS, LMFT, and he is also the narrator. This audiobook was published by Internet Therapist, LLC, copyright 2005.
This discussion about boundaries stands alone, but it should also be viewed as a corollary to the dysfunctional family paper, the codependent paper, and the communications section, because a person can't really be a good communicator without good boundaries. The definition of boundaries is the ability to know where you end and where another person begins. It is also the ability to defend yourself while not offending someone else. Another aspect is the ability to take good care of yourself while not trying to take care of or have responsibility for another. Secondarily, for our purposes, it is fair fighting and conflict resolution. There is no way that a person can have good, healthy boundaries unless they were taught appropriate boundaries at some point in their life. And one cannot teach good boundaries unless they have good boundaries. In order to have good appropriate boundaries, a person has to know himself or herself. Very often in dysfunctional families, as a number of people come from, they are systematically taught some very crazy rules that make this self-knowledge problematic. These rules are addressed more in the dysfunctional family paper. One of these dysfunctional family rules is the idea of being perfect, which is a crazed thought. If a person believes that they have to be perfect, they will become shut off from a very large part of their emotional and intellectual self-knowledge, which does not allow for the establishment of healthy boundaries. There is no way a person could have good boundaries if they buy into that particular logic. If a parent feels they and the child have to be perfect, then that parent will systematically disagree and invalidate many aspects and characteristics that the child has that would simply be human. An example is a child who is sick and tells their parents that they feel sick. The child is making a boundary statement. What they're saying is, inside my reality, this is going on. I'm sharing it with you, a separate person. If a parent then turns around and says, no, you're not sick, that is crazy making for the child. The child will look inside, they'll look at the parent, they'll look inside, then they'll look at the parent again. And because kids need to feel that parents are always right and that they are solid and powerful so that the child will feel safe, they will assume that they are wrong and bad. The child will take on the blame and assume that their perception is faulty. As a result, a large part of their reality is now dissociated out of their body and out of their awareness, and their self-esteem suffers. The effects are even worse than that because they begin to look towards other people to define who they are and what they feel. That is a very fundamental aspect of codependence, and this type of interaction tends to cause this problem. If someone doesn't realize who they are, if they don't have a good sense of reality testing, then they fail to develop the capacity to defend themselves or even to assert their own reality. The result of this type of parenting is learned helplessness. To give an example, about 10 years ago I took up fencing, and because I came from an abusive alcoholic family where I had a very physically abusive father, as a child I learned that he had a right to do things to me, but I did not have a right to do anything to him except defend. In fencing, when somebody comes at you with a sword, you are supposed to block it and then immediately riposte or stab back. It's called marrying the riposte to the parry. It took me several months to change from simply parrying, which I felt comfortable with, to actually taking a physically aggressive action and thrusting, because I had developed learned helplessness from my family of origin. At first, children have no boundaries at all. They are egocentric. That means, very simply, that they are concerned with themselves. If one really looks at the whole idea of being a child, it's a full-time job. Children are terribly vulnerable. They lack mastery in almost everything. It would be as if a person had a tremendous case of the flu, which makes their focus go inside until the person feels better. They care about others, but they don't have time to show that. That kind of egocentricity is perfectly understandable. Children are needy. They don't think a lot about other people. And yet they're human, which means they make mistakes. If parents do not understand this is normal and natural, then the child is not going to develop appropriately. They are going to be blamed for simply being human, and they are not going to be able to develop healthy boundaries. People are often told that immaturity and egocentricity are bad, but they are not. It is just age appropriate. Children need time, attention, and direction. When parents attack a child's neediness, that child learns to hate himself or herself and tries not to need. At that point, they don't develop boundaries, which is simply where one ends off and someone else begins. Instead, they set up walls and erect barricades to keep themselves inside, safe, and other people out. Walls are not permeable. Walls are permanent, and they tend to enslave people inside. They are also not effective boundaries. Parents cannot teach boundaries unless they have them, and they can't have them unless they themselves have been taught. That's how the poisonous pedagogy that we've been educated by for years and years unfortunately continues to cause problems. Very often in dysfunctional families, the idea of simple privacy, of allowing doors to be closed in the family home, is viewed as somehow an affront against the family system. There are very few instances of appropriate boundaries in these families. When a child does not have boundaries and has no idea of what normal is, it is very much like a doorway where the door is not there. Just an empty room. That is essentially what kids in a tremendously dysfunctional family deal with. If somebody says something shameful, it will immediately have an impact on them and wash over them. The child will take it in and tend to believe it. That is an indication of no boundaries whatsoever. They don't realize that they can defend themselves, that there just might be the possibility that the other person is wrong about what was said or wrong about the way it was said. As with any problem, there is a continuum of boundary difficulties that people suffer from. If a person has developed a few appropriate boundaries, either in childhood or through therapy, as if the doorknob is on the outside of the door, so that in general, their sense of reality is protected. But if somebody hits a weak or hot button for them, a sensitive area that has not really healed, it's as if the abuser has opened up the door, thrown a bomb in, closed the door, and the person blows up. When the person has developed truly appropriate boundaries, the doorknob is on the inside of the door. That means that if somebody says something that seems to make sense, the individual might open the door, really take a look at what has been said, and then decide if the information is appropriate for them or not. If the information is a correct criticism, they will realize the difference between personhood and behavior. Guilt is about behavior, shame is about personhood. They'll only open up to what makes sense. If not, it will bounce off the door and they won't be personally affected by it. That's a good indication of appropriate boundaries. When a person has internalized shame, it is difficult to recognize when another person is attempting to shame them or if it was unintentional. For example, imagine a person walks into a room and they have shoes that haven't been shined, and somebody turns to them and says, "Well, it looks like it's time for a shine." By the tone of voice, it is apparent this time that the person was attempting to shame the other person. But if the person is healthy, it's going to bounce off and not really affect them. They're going to be able to detach and turn to that person and confront them calmly, as if they're the one with the problem. It doesn't impact them. They might say, "You know, it sounds like you were really trying to put me down." A person can at times tell by the other person's tone of voice, their facial expressions, and their reply whether they were attempting to shame or not. Based on the reply, a more direct confrontation can be done if needed. Another example is when the motivation of the other person is harder to figure out. Another person says, "It looks like it might be time for a shine," and the tone is neutral. But what the shame-bound person might well hear is almost the same tone that was said the first time, as if the person was trying to hurt them. When shame is hit, it's as if the entire chest is opened up, and the shame-bound person assumes other people see horrible, nasty things that define them as a person. People so affected either crumble or put up a wall, and then they start throwing back insults of their own. Either way, the shame has taken hold. The only way to completely release shame is for people to admit that they feel shameful, express how they feel, but realize from their adult position that it doesn't necessarily have anything to do with them, that it's a matter of early learning and whatever button somebody hit. Therefore, in the second example, it would be helpful to essentially say the same thing as in the first. "I heard what you said, and I wasn't sure if you were trying to shame me or not, were you?" The person should give the other person a chance to say how they feel. If their response seems valid by their bearing and tone of voice, one can assume that they were not intentionally attempting to shame. Unfortunately, when people have poor boundaries, they not only have a problem standing up for themselves, but they often have a problem hearing things correctly. The tendency is to hear it through a veneer of negativity. The shame-bound person will sometimes even add words incorrectly to what was said to them. A third example of feeling shame would be a person walking through a room knowing that his or her shoes need shining, and assuming that everyone is looking at and judging them, even though no one has said a word. It makes sense to ask a person if they are thinking poorly about you, as long as that person is not a professional abuser. If a person does not verbalize how they are feeling and thinking, they often assume the worst. The person will walk away with new evidence that the other people are judging them, and they might be wrong. If a person shares how they are viewing whatever dynamic is occurring, they can get a better sense of how accurate they are by that reality testing. If a person does not say something to get the shame out, it's never going to dissipate. There are internal boundaries for any person that entail setting limits, knowing themselves, and being a good parent to the self. There are external boundaries that are more about setting limits with other people and making sure that abuse does not occur. There is a sexual and physical aspect to external boundaries that are expandable to let people in and out depending on what we want and feel is appropriate at any given time. In other words, boundaries are not rigid. one might want to get closer to some people and further apart from others. There is a physical, even territorial, aspect to healthy boundaries. The internal boundaries, according to Pia Melody, an expert in this field, are more emotional, spiritual, and intellectual. They have to do with thinking and feeling about a person's own reality, their definition of themselves, and their point of view. Some cultures have much wider boundaries, and some are very restrictive. Many boundaries vary between societies. There are some boundaries, though, that are universal no matter what culture a person comes from. Most cultures would agree that there are very few reasons to allow killing. That is a negative or a taboo in most cultures. But the amount of touching that goes on and with whom is very often cultural. Men in some European countries, for example, kiss on the cheek as a greeting. Most Americans would tend to be abhorred by that. The present discussion is going to focus in detail on external boundaries. Unfair or abusive fighting are usually boundary violations. The definition of a boundary violation is the violation of a person's physical or mental state, which is different for every person. Abuse means not useful. Therefore, in the broadest sense, anything that is not useful in human communication may be deemed abuse. In our culture, we define actions as abusive only if they are physical or sexual in nature. Abuse is just simply not useful. If one is trying to relate to people or trying to get a conflict resolved, then only useful communication techniques should be employed. If two people are having a disagreement about a particular topic and one of them gets abusive, that topic should be put on hold and the abuse needs to be dealt with first in order to reestablish good boundaries before they can go back to that original argument. It's just like a basketball game. If somebody elbows a player in the face, the referee stops the game, a penalty point is assessed, the player then gets a free throw, and then the game resumes. The same applies here. If a person does not stop and deal with the abuse, then the person is allowing and normalizing the other person's behavior. No matter what happens with the original argument, that person won't feel good about themselves, nor will they have a sense of their own reality. The list of abusive behavior will be addressed individually. The first one is always. The reason this is listed as abusive is because if a person says something is always this or that, they are thinking as a perfectionist. Only little kids think this way. It is not appropriate to sit and have an argument with a child. If a person is acting and thinking shame-based and child-based and using the word always, one should stop the conversation, confront that, and let him or her know in the best possible way, without putting him or her down, that it's not possible for a person to always do anything, and the thinking should be reconsidered. Unless the other person can see that, there's no point in continuing the conversation because it's already spiraling down. It's not going to get better unless the abusive person retreats from this position, essentially seeing reality or adult behavior. The next boundary foul is never. It's an impossibility to never treat a person well, or to never pick up around the house. The third abusive rule is saying you. Starting out a statement with you is a blaming statement. If people are trying to resolve a disagreement or a conflict, what they want to do is treat each other respectfully. A conflict does not have to be a fight. The principal should look for a solution and not care about who wins. If that is happening, there's no reason to blame. People have to realize that there are different points of view, that most things are about perception, and that reality is a very hard thing for people to agree on. It is important to use I statements, as in how I feel or how I think, because that's going to be more accurate than you did this. If a person says you, the other party will go on the defensive and stop listening. If a person says I, the other person will tend to lean towards them. The next abusive technique is a yelling voice. The reason that this is so abusive is that energy can be abusive or healthy. Energy emits several feet outside of the body. Imagine walking into a room where two people are fighting, or there are two people who are attracted to each other. The energy can be felt all the way across the room. If a person is yelling, they're essentially verbally abusing somebody else. It's an attack. Calling names is another form of abuse. It is not an appropriate communication technique. What is not aimed toward constructively fixing an issue will not resolve anything. Cussing is usually unnecessary and is generally used as a manipulative ploy to try to put the other person on the defensive. If a person occasionally uses a curse, but it is not cussing at somebody, they might be able to get away with it. For the most part, it's unneeded. Bringing up the past is often a way to pin somebody down and try to put them in a one-down position that will hurt. An example of this would be a couple where one person has had an affair. If the other person forgives them, then the issue is supposed to be resolved. If it can be resolved, it is going to take some time for the trust to return. However, if at a much later time the couple is walking through a mall and the aggrieved person says, "I bet you're attracted to that person is bringing up the past in a frivolous manner. What they're really saying is, "Look, I'm too dependent to leave you, so I'm going to stay with you and beat the hell out of you for the rest of my existence." That is not getting over anything. Now, if the offending spouse has another affair and the person mentions the previous affair, that's an entirely different matter. It is appropriate to bring up previous issues if it relates to a present one. Categorizing or comparing is a way to put somebody down. It's unnecessary and used as a tool in an ongoing power struggle. Not listening to another person's side is another abusive tactic. Communication is supposed to be a 50-50 street, with each person waiting until the other is finished speaking. The person is supposed to really want the other person to have a good point of view. If they do, the two will probably be able to resolve the matter much more quickly. It is not about winning, but about solving. Turning away or walking away is abandonment. Abandonment is an atrocious activity. It shames people. It makes them feel lousy. Sarcasm is a passive-aggressive ploy. It is an attempt to attack or retaliate, but with the ability to say, "I didn't really mean it." As with all of these abusive rules, it treats the person with less than dignity. Laughing at another person is a foul in communication. Mocking another person is similar, but even more harmful, because one is taking on their characteristics in a demeaning way. Demanding to talk at inappropriate times is childlike and acting in a spoiled manner. If a person has a partner and they feel hurt by that partner, they have a right to ask that partner to talk. However, there's nothing in the world that says they have to talk. They should certainly try to, but there are times when it's appropriate and times when it is not. For example, people calling others at work because they have a feeling they want taken care of immediately, even though the time is inappropriate. What they are looking for is unconditional love from a parent, and that is something that no one has a right to give or to ask for. 15 is passive-aggressive behavior. There are a host of passive-aggressive techniques. Some of them are pouting, slamming doors, whining, making faces, and the silent treatment. All of these behavior types are passive and childlike. Talking over the last part of the person's sentence goes against the timing of a discussion. It becomes something other than a 50-50 conversation. Hitting or throwing things are examples of physical abuse. Using weak points are attempts to win or put someone down. If the desire is to use the weak point to hurt them, then it's abusive. If a person is saying something that is true, and their reason for doing it is to discuss a problem and not to defend, then that is entirely different. Lecturing is a type of communication that often occurs with a boss or spouse, as if somehow it's okay to treat somebody like a kid. It is always abusive. Interrogating is acting manipulatively. The person knows what they're upset about, but instead of saying it directly, they ask 20 questions to try to pin the person down like a lawyer does, and then trap them. It's a one-up power play. Monopolizing the conversation violates the flow of communication. It's a boundary invasion. Asking inappropriate questions is over the person's boundary, and that includes love relationships. There is some information that a person doesn't necessarily get to know about another person just because they're lovers. Getting mad about one thing but talks about another is very indirect. This happens quite frequently. The person is afraid to talk about the real issue, so they punish the other person by talking about another unrelated issue. It's indirect, it's not helpful, and it does not help turn a conflict into resolution. Threatening statements or behavior are an aggressive act. Blackmail is a manipulative ploy. An ultimatum has as its purpose an attempt to scare the person enough to have them do what the other person wants. That is different than somebody coming up with a bottom line statement. In other words, if a person says to their partner, "I can't be around this kind of drinking," and in their mind they are leaving, that is a bottom line statement. That's fine. If they're using that as a ploy to get the drinker to change, then it's a foul. Attempting to guilt trip or shame instead of talking about how the person feels and what they think is going on is another foul. Moving across physical boundaries with gestures or movements, facial expressions, and tone of voice is abusive. Threatening physical gestures or movements are a form of physical abuse. Taking the other's inventory is another foul. This is a 12-step term from Alcoholics Anonymous that basically means pointing out all of the other person's character flaws so that they'll win, rather than saying what they feel about what's happening in the relationship. An example of conditional love is "I'll marry you if you." That's manipulation. Acting condescending is a one-up, one-down position. And again, there's no way that one is looking for a solution if they're acting that way. The person is looking to draw blood. If the person who has been abused doesn't stop any of these fouls, they are really saying, "I am unworthy, go ahead and abuse me." Appropriate boundaries are not being taken care of, and if a person doesn't take care of boundaries, they can't feel good about themselves. Breaking confidences is another abusive tactic. Concerns shared between two people should remain between them. Confidences should not be shared, even if a person thinks it wouldn't matter. One of the hallmarks of dysfunctional families is third-party communication and alliances, and it gets crazy because a person never knows who's telling the truth. It's all about intensity rather than intimacy. It's a lot easier just to keep conversations one-on-one. Third-party communication is a foul. It should be avoided like the plague. Lying is certainly unfair. Breaking promises repeatedly impedes good communication. Not being supportive emotionally is also abusive. Be careful with this. It doesn't mean a person should always get what they want. It means that if a person is going to be involved in a relationship, they should act in an emotional and not in a withholding manner. This does not mean a person gets what they want when they want it. Acting critical, calling names, bringing up the past to hurt someone are all abusive. Neglecting the other person's needs deliberately is another example of childlike fighting. Pushing buttons on purpose is another abusive technique. Making fun or treating someone like a child or a parent is equally abusive. Treating them as an inferior or superior doesn't allow for the full individuality of the person. That person is treating the individual as a role more than a person. It is not respectful. Ignores or doesn't listen to the other's opinion makes true communication impossible. That doesn't mean they have to agree with each other, but they should be able to listen to each other's opinions and take them seriously. Being disrespectful or rude in any way, such as reading the newspaper when someone is talking, is abusive. Not taking no for an answer and continuing to step over someone's boundaries is also impolite. Acting pushy is another example of not respecting another person and their rights. Someone who gives advice not asked for has no real sense of individual boundaries. It's a very codependent thing to do and a presumptuous one. Why should a person tell another what they should do? Why should they think that they know better? My guess is if a person needs help, they'll ask for it. They don't need prompting. Acting in a demanding way, being judgmental, trying to fix or save, being manipulative or blaming, all are actions that essentially do not treat the other person as a respectful individual adult. Shotgun blasting is not staying on one subject long enough to resolve it, hitting on as many weak points as the person can muster. That is not done with the purpose of resolving anything. Physical abuse or sexual abuse of any kind is not to be tolerated. This includes sexualization, which is basically talking about sexual issues in an inappropriate way, telling sexual jokes to people who are underage, or treating someone in too familiar a manner. There should be an appropriate sense of ebb and flow to a conversation. though people don't often have it. They also quite often have a poor idea of territorial boundaries. I once had a friend who was very tall, about 6'7", and he would stand only a couple of inches away. At the time, I didn't want to hurt his feelings, which was a very codependent way of thinking, so I'd back up and he would follow because his sense of physical space was only an inch away. And that's what he felt was appropriate. He wasn't doing something deliberately mean, he just wasn't aware of doing it. Strings attached to gifts is another foul. Gifts are simply gifts, they are not barter. If it is barter, the person who wants it should let the other person know what the contract is. Withholding behavior is usually a technique just to get back at the other person for some perceived wrong. If someone doesn't want to do something, that's fine. If a person does not want to do it in order to retaliate, that is not. Inappropriate secrets or threats are also abusive. There shouldn't be any kind of threats, and usually secrets are unnecessary. This is different than minding your own business. Telling secrets is usually a hostile act against another person. Excessive teasing is a passive-aggressive form of abuse. A person winds up hurting someone and then denies that it ever happened or claims the intent was pure. In conclusion, good communication is about treating the other person with dignity and trying to resolve situations amicably. This is most often done by appropriate compromise and negotiation so that each person is satisfied by the result. There is simply no place for abuse. The main focus of this section has been about stopping abuse from the outside, and I think it's a very important part. But internal boundaries are also important. Therefore, taking care of oneself is very much a part of healthy boundaries. In order to maintain good, healthy boundaries, a person needs to practice moderation and take care of themselves by thinking realistically, speaking to themselves nicely, eating well and taking vitamins, getting sufficient sleep and exercise, and going to the doctor when necessary. People coming from dysfunctional families are not taught many of these behaviors. As important as it is to defend against external abuse, one needs to make sure they are not abusing themselves and focus instead on the whole idea of moderation.
Jef Gazley, MS, LMFT, has practiced psychotherapy for over 30 years and is the owner-operator of www.asktheinternettherapist.com since 1998 and www.hypnosistapesforhealth.com since 2004. He is the author of 8 mental health educational videos and DVDs and is currently writing a book on distance counseling. Jef is state licensed in general counseling, marriage, family, and substance abuse. He is dedicated to guiding individuals to achieving a lifelong commitment to mental health and relationship mastery. In his private practice in Scottsdale, Arizona, Jef specializes in ADD, love addiction, hypnotherapy, dysfunctional families, codependency, and trauma. He is a trained counselor in EMDR, NET, TFT, and is a certified clinical hypnotist and hypnotherapist. Jef received his BA in psychology, history, and teaching from the University of Washington and his master's in counseling from the University of Oregon. His hobbies include music and a love for all sports, which he's an expert fencer. His favorite readings are history, biographies, and Russian authors. Jef resides in Scottsdale, Arizona with his partner Janice.